A great big spicy hello to you. This is Diana Price, and I'm just, checking out all the stuff that we're going to be talking about today. I hope you had a chance to check out dpriceassociates.com. And the whole blog post is what we're going to be talking about today. So did you get a chance to take a look at our blog post? I'm going to tell you about that in a minute. But welcome. Really, really appreciate having you here. We're here every Tuesday from 12 noon to 1 p.m. Pacific time. And we give you the ingredients for business success. And today, we're going to be giving you three secrets. Count them, three secrets. And that's only the beginning. But these three secrets are for spicing up your customer-centric culture. You know that what we talk about on the show and what my business imperative is creating exceptional customer experiences. That's the only way you can keep leads and profit flowing through your pipeline. So head on over to dpriceassociates.com because we're going to talk about customer service. I think it's a lot. It's really routine today. It's robotic. People do the things because they're used to doing it. But the whole purpose of what we're talking about today is to give you these valuable nuggets that you can use right now in your business. And you know me, I love sharing. I love giving. I love just talking about the impact that we have on each other and how it can lead or distract from your business success. So one of the things that I want to share my focus and my knowledge for you today is we're going to talk about, you know, what is a business culture, and if you have one, awesome, and if you don't, why not? What gives it value, and why do I say you need to spice it up? And what I mean by spice it up is putting more value and putting more flavor into your service. When you go to a restaurant, at least when I go to the restaurant, I usually look for something flavorful and that tastes really good on the menu. When I find it, guess what? I like it. I might order it over and over and over again. So when I say customer service is too robotic, think about it. Do people smile these days? Do they really get that they have to be authentic and fake smiles? We can all see right through them. So I've been serving leaders and in the medical profession and small business for well over 20 years. So all of my research, all the evidence that I bring you is all factual. So I have a lot of awesome facts to share with you today. And we're going to get started with our first segment. And the first segment that I want to talk to you about is how much of the little things are you missing in your business? And I have some notes here that I want to be sure to share with you. How much of the little things are you missing in your business? So I want you to follow along with me. If you have a pen or if you have your digital device, your whatever you want, I want you to follow along with me today. But let me just make sure you know that it's a blessing for me. It's a real privilege to share my knowledge about service. I don't care a lot about transactional things, and I hear you, and I know you hear me say that all the time. The transaction, you know, that's not what it's all about. It's about how you interact, how you really relate to someone. So the blessing that I have is building and creating that trust between you and your customers and your employees, because your employees are your customers as well. And once you build that connection, I show you how to do it with spice and flavor, not just do it with the normal average Joe Blow way. So the process that we're going to go through today is just that. It's a process. And my background is, yeah, I don't know if you know, I was a business major at USC, communication major at USC, so that led me to corporate America, where I had well more than 20 years of leadership in corporate America. So from not only the Annenberg School of Communication, but also the School of Hard Knocks. Have you ever been to that school? Yeah. I think I continue to go to that school because the School of Hard Knocks is a school that we never, never, never get rid of. So we always kind of have that School of Hard Knocks close to us. So when we talk about your spicing up your service interaction. Think about how this relates to you and your business. This is definitely something that you want to do if you love what you do, but maybe only 10 to 20% of your business is coming from repeat clients. So you probably need a much higher repeat client ratio. If you think that your service is good, I think it's good. I mean, if you think it's good, good is okay, but good is not good enough. Okay, so if you think your service is good, it's not good enough. And if you think it's really good, you know, there might be some places that you can also improve it. So this whole conversation is completely for you. Now, if your team does not always know what to say, if they don't always know what to do, if they find themselves in emergency situations and you haven't given them a process to follow, this is for you. Now, if you need to step up and speed up your customer service and get it more in the spotlight and not the sale in the process, because it's, don't even get me started. To me, delight is the sale. So the service culture that we're going to be talking about today is going to get you exactly to that road. Now, and the bottom line is when I get done with you, you're going to be able to use customer service as a profit strategy. So I want you to just sit back. But the first thing I want to talk to you about is all these little things that we completely overlook. So the little things that if you take a look at how you are greeted in your business, how much of that greeting is authentic? How much is that greeting is someone looking away, doing something else, distracted by a phone call, distracted by another employee talking to them, or just jabbering away and talking in front of the customer? That's kind of a little thing, isn't it? But it could be a real big thing to the success of your business. So I have a what I call a 7-step process. We're only going to be able to get to one part of that process today in our conversation, but I gotta tell you, when you get ready to hear the whole thing, you're going to want a whole lot more. So some of the little things, the first segment that we're going to talk about is how much of the little things are you missing? Here's number one. Did I tell you good was not good enough? So customers have an emotional connection with you. They will spend, if you don't know this, 46% more than a satisfied customer if they have an emotional connection with you. So how small is it to use their name? How important is that teeny little thing? I told you about smiling. I told you about really connecting and interacting. These are teeny tiny little things. Another little thing that you have to be mindful of. Be a great listener. We're not taught how to listen in school. We're taught how to interrupt. We're taught how to, well, I shouldn't say that, but we tend to interrupt more than we listen. We need to take a good look at the feel that we're giving. The feel, the body language that we have, the words that we say, the tone of voice, how we speak, what we say and how we say it is so important. These are little things, and these are not things that you don't already know. But let's continue with the little things. Be a great listener. Just really be a great listener. So, I'm a customer. You're a customer. What do I want? I want solutions to my problems. I don't give a care about your product. I don't care what the benefits are. Does it meet my need? That's what I want to know. Customers buy solutions to their problems. They don't buy your products and they don't buy your services. If you know this, you'll better understand how to tell your customer how what you do, what you offer, solves their problems. You have to anticipate their needs and any problems that are coming up. Okay, are you getting this? I hope you're getting this. All right, so let's go on to another very important part of the teeny tiny little things. And I'm not going to be able to, I'm looking at how many little things I have. I'm not going to be able to get to all the little things. However, Here's some more of the little things that I want you to really internalize. A sincere compliment. When you interact with someone, try to find something that's very sincere to share with them. You know, don't go out of your way to make a compliment that really is meaningless or a compliment that you know is insincere. So think about how you can make a sincere compliment every time that you are in your customer's presence, completely in your customer's presence. Because what this does, you know, it lightens up the whole atmosphere. It really helps you start that relationship. People love to talk about themselves, so when you say something nice about them, you know, they get all jittery and smiley, so it's really cool. It's really cool. But make sure you convey the sincerity in your body language and in your words and in your actions when you do that. Don't make it really fake, because people can see right through that. Also, yes, yes is a very powerful word. This is something that so many businesses are missing. And let me tell you how I think they're missing saying yes. I could give you so many examples, but just think for a moment. The last time you went to a business or a retail or to buy a product, and you were there in person, and they told you all the reasons why either they couldn't help you, or how it was against their policy, or how we don't do it like that here, or all of those no. Instead of using those same things, even though you may not be able to do everything a customer wants you to do, you can say to your customer, here's what I can do. I can find out about that. I can have someone call you back. This is what I can do. Yes, I can do. Now, all the no stuff that you can't do, you turn it around and you see who can help them with it. And you can say, yeah, oh, yes, I'm going to get so-and-so who knows so much, they're an expert in that. I'm going to get them to work with you and make that happen for you. Do you see the difference in saying, no? It's so innate, and it's so automatic in some of our customer service professionals' thinking. The first thing they say is, no, we can't do that, or no, or, you know, I don't think so. No. So really, you have to start thinking before you speak. I have a ebook that I've wrote, avoiding all of those awful phrases, and start thinking before you speak. So that's very important. Another little thing is that you want to try to avoid is when customers interact with you, how many times do they have to go through and jump through ropes and have to listen to your jargon and have to press 0 and then press 1 and then get to another department, and then if you want this one, you say yes or no, and you say yes and you got to go through a whole different menu of stuff. That is just... It's too many systems. Change these little systems to something that's a lot more customer friendly. Simplify the transaction for your customer. You want to have that human element. So if your customer objects to that, what's the alternative? If you don't have an alternative, it's pretty bad. We're going to take a quick break, because I could go on for hours about the little things that you might be missing your business. If you want more information about that, you know how to reach us. Diana@DianaPriceAssociates.com is how you can email us. And you can always call us at area code 866-631-7500. So, but for now, if you're not at our Facebook page, go there. Facebook.com/SpicyBusinessTalk. And we'll be right back.
Hi, this is Mark Harris from the Thought Leadership Alliance, and I just had a delightful time with Diana Price. You know, she just had me on her Spicy Business Talk show here, and it was really an awesome experience. She knows really how to bring some great stuff out of the people that she has on our show. And if you're a business owner of any kind, and you really need to have somebody help you bring out the great stuff that's already in you, and you really want to make your dreams, take it to the next level, I would strongly suggest you work with Diana Price and her company, because she's really good at what she does. I had an enjoyable experience. I work with some of the best people in the world in the industries and things like this, and she's a true professional, and you'd find the same thing with her. So I'd strongly suggest you do that. This is Mark Harris. I hope you have a great day, and talk to you soon.
Hi, welcome back. This is Diana Price, and you're listening to Diana's Spicy Business Talk Radio. And we're listening to, and I'm listening too as you're listening. But what we are doing today is really getting to the bottom of the robotic feeling that we as customers get when we interact, when we go out and we try to buy products. The one thing that I do want to share with you, because we were talking about the little things that we miss. Some of the most important little thing, I gotta just jump forward and get part of that in there, because some of the most important little things that are so vital for serving your customer and exceeding their expectations, confidentiality. I am not going to go one word further without getting confidentiality in here. Managing very sensitive information and getting to really respect your customer is vital. No gossiping, because if you and your team are gossiping while your customer might be waiting for someone else, you know, they may be thinking, oh my God, they're gossiping about that customer. I turn my back, they'll be gossiping about me too. Okay, confidentiality, very, very, very important. Compassion, I'm going to run through these real quick, because these are some things I never, ever want you to forget. Compassion, you have to understand, you have to empathize. Don't upset your customer. They pay your bills, they're your paycheck. 3, responsiveness, quick response. Make sure you oblige them. Oblige them in a way that you could, that they're the only thing right now happening and they're in front of you, okay? Restraint, customers are defiant. Customers are right, but they're not always right. But you have to make them feel that they're always right. And there's a wonderful way to do that, okay? Pay attention. Pay attention to their body language, pay attention to what they say, and pay attention to what they do not say. Don't miss the important details, because, you know, I was teaching at a doctor's office, and one of the things sometimes when patients call a doctor's office, what do they do? Or even new patients call, the prospective patients, they call and they say, you know, I have such and such an ailment, and how late are you open, and you know, all the things that the customers don't say, the patients don't say, is what you really need to be focusing on. So when you focus on that, you can turn that in, for a doctor, for example, to an appointment, and you can turn it in to a sale. So make sure you really focus and pay attention, and don't miss those very, very, very important details. So now we're going to go further, and we're going to talk now about how you set the tone. Now, to set the tone for your culture, first of all, I want you to know that you have to have a culture. You have to have a customer-centric culture to begin with. What we've done is try to introduce the fact that these are the little things that you have to think about when you're developing your customer culture. When you're developing a culture of your business, that's going to lead a lot more to profits, because you interact with them, you know exactly what they do, you can use what you learn and transfer that into results and revenue. So I want you to write down while you're listening to me your definition of your culture. Whatever you have for your business, if it's in writing, you should know it. It should be a snap. Okay, my customer mission, my service culture is, write that down. And now I'm going to ask you a question about that. I'll give you a second to write it down. First of all, you should have a written definition of your service culture. If you don't have a written definition of your service culture, it's going to be defined for you. Regardless if it's good, bad, or indifferent, it's going to be defined for you. So let's talk about what is a culture. Think about that. Just think about the word culture before we put service in front of it. So culture, if you think about it, it could be a group of people. It could be a nationality. It could be how people relate to each other, how a family relates to each other. It could be, if you think about a culture, it could be spiritual, it could be a religion. But let me tell you what my definition is for a service culture. My definition, Diana Price and Associates, our definition is a service culture is a shared value system. It's a system of beliefs and it's a system of attributes, and it characterizes and influences the perception of you and your business. So let me say that again. A service culture, from my definition, is a shared value system, beliefs and attributes that influences and characterizes the perception of you and your business. So when you don't have it defined, if you turn your back and you decide to do something else, or if your team is in the middle of emergency or, you know, putting out fires and they have no process, they have no system, they have nothing to go by, they're going to make it up as they go along. And guess what that's going to do? It's going to impact. It's going to reflect on your business. So let me tell you a little bit more about why I want you to write this down. I want you and your team to know how to express it easily, clearly, flawlessly, just like that. If they don't have a specific process, if they don't know what they're doing, if you're not there, if there's an emergency, whatever they have encountered, they may be forced to figure something out. And when they have to figure it out, boy, is it going to reflect on you. Good, bad, or indifferent, it's going to reflect on you. Okay, so we know that the service culture is the perception of you and your business. It's a shared value. It's a culture. It's a shared value. It's a culture that you see. That's a culture that they see themselves a part of. It's a part of the workplace environment. It's how they define themselves as a part of your business. That's all it is. But it's very important that if someone asks them, that everybody is saying the same thing. If everybody is saying the same thing, you're on the right page. If they're not, well, your culture probably needs to be refueled and reshaped. Okay, so I think we've talked a little bit about that, so I want you to really memorize this. This is something that I absolutely love. You know, a part of I see culture every day. I see how people respond to each other. I see how people, you know, I just had an experience where we're out of town with family just recently. And when you go to restaurants, it doesn't have to be, it could be anywhere. When you go to restaurants, how servers, how, you know, people that you buy from, the salespeople, how they react, how they respond to customers, it's really changing. That's one of the reasons I thought I have got to talk about how customer service is just so robotic. It's awful. It's awful. I don't know how to say it any other way than it is completely, completely awful. So, you know, when you decide on your culture, when you decide you're going to create the perfect service vision, when you're going to get your customers to rave about what you do, you have to make a business choice to be warm and personal. And you may have to change your mindset a little bit from what it is now. You may have to take a look at oh my God, it's so phony for me to use their name. Oh, it's so phony for me to find out, you know, something that I can compliment them on. Get over it, because if you don't get over it, you know, you're gonna just stop having leads funnel through your pipeline. Just understand that. Because the next competitor, your competitor, is going to find a way to do this, not only in a really spicy and flavorful way, they're just going to keep inventing and refueling and reshaping. And if you say, oh, well, our stuff is good enough, ah, what we're doing is just fine, couldn't have it any better, you know, I feel really sorry for you. This stuff is not rocket science, but you have to dent it in, and you have to understand it, and you have to review it and review it and review it and review it, and you have to do it over and over again until you get it, until you don't have to look at it, until you don't have to think about it. Instead of that gossiping, when your team is gossiping, when they have nothing else to do, they're figuring out a way to make exceptional customer experiences. So I hope you get this. So, well, a couple other things about setting the tone. We're talking about setting the tone. When you choose your culture, it's important that enthusiasm is a part of it. Energy is a part of it. Think about how you want to retain your customers. Think about how your energy influences every interaction or lack thereof. You know, if someone comes up to you in a tone of voice that's, oh my God, so disruptive and abrupt, how are you going to feel about doing business with them? And if they say those exact same words, and you have a tone of voice, and they have, you have a tone, your team has a tone of voice that is just so delightful, guess who would you choose? I know who would I choose. And you may get more complaints from the other one, when from the people that just have that sucky tone of voice. So remember that compassion, energy, enthusiasm is how you're going to really set the tone and create some raving fans. So always be ready to match your vision with your customer's vision, and be ready to receive, be ready to know that your customer is not going to always be right, but you're not going to have an ego to get out there and say, you're wrong, I'm right, this is our policy, this is what it says, look, that's not the way to do it, even though that's the way it is. If you do it that way, you're heading in the wrong direction. So, I think we're getting to the part of the hour where we're going to move on to another part of our awesome service training today, and it's going to be, I was just getting like all these gestures, I'm sorry, but I want you to be sure that all of these little things and all these things that set the tone, just know that they are so vital to your flavor and the value that you're creating. And we'll be right back to give you a lot more nuggets. This is Diana Price, and you're listening to Diana's Spicy Business Talk Radio. Stay tuned.
Hello, I'm Jana Stefanis, the founder of Global Institute for Love Aligned Spiritual Enrichment. I'm also a divine healer, spiritual teacher, and advisor. I was just on Diana Price's Spicy Business Talk, and she is just a wonderful woman who I absolutely adore. The program was great. She really gave some great insight and allowed me to share the beautiful spiritual transformation that I've gone through and the lessons that I've learned. And she is just such a great person to allow you to share your message and to direct and guide you into how to make the most of that, so you can really be the gift you're created to be in the world and to share that message and do it with such beauty and grace. She has such a heart for service, and it's just a wonderful woman that I would highly recommend that you work with and you bring on to either be on her program or to help you in your business, to help you get aligned with your own message. So thank you, Diana. I appreciate all your friendship. I appreciate your professionalism, and I appreciate your heart for service. Thank you.
Hi, welcome back. This is Diana Price, and we're just having a good time talking about the impact that you have on customers, your tone of voice, talking about the little things that we so often overlook. We overlook the little things like there's nobody's business. So we've talked about two of the secrets. We've got three. the secret number one is all the little things we talked about that we overlook in providing service and getting to profit. The little things that we overlook are just things that you just have to be a lot more in tune to. And then the other thing we talked about is how do you set the tone? You know, how do you set the tone with your confidentiality, with all the things around you, with your tone of voice, with your body language, with all the things that we know we should be doing, but sometimes it just gets past us. And now we're going to go into how to sharpen our focus. How to sharpen our focus a little bit, because when you think about the automatic things that we do, the things that are Timmy wrote, the things that are robotic, it's really a shame. But I want to talk about why it is that when you go to an establishment, when you go to a business, when you talk to someone on the phone, many times the person that's the first person that greets you, that person is probably the youngest, the newest, not, I don't mean the youngest, I mean the newest person on the team that may or may not have been trained appropriately. So sharpening your focus really impacts customer satisfaction. So when you sharpen your perspective and you open your mind to some new ways of thinking when it comes to how you relate to your customer, then you know that how well you perform, how well you perform as a leader, how well you declare service values of a leader, and how well you communicate that with your team. You have to sharpen that focus, and you have to really dent it in a positive, motivational way all the time, because your customers are not only those customers that pay you every day. Yeah, it's the customers that you pay every day, too. It's your employees. It's both. Yeah, I've said that many times. So, first thing about sharpening your focus, number one, how well do you and how well do your employees know your job? I mean, how well? When I gave that analogy about the first person that you see is, you know, the receptionist, and maybe they're the newest kid on the block and you haven't been out there hand-holding and training them, and they're, oh, I don't know, I don't know. I mean, they're given the first impression of your business, you like it or not. So it should be the most senior person, or you darn well better be out there training them and declaring service as the top priority, okay? So, I expect, sharpening your focus, I expect you and your employees to know what they're doing. I don't care if they are this first time on the job. If they don't know what they're doing, that's really going to impact how I feel about your business and the service that you provide. I don't care, in this case, I don't care how empathetic, how enthusiastic, if they don't know what they're doing, that is a bottom line, basic, baseline attribute. The baseline is, you better know what you're doing if you're out there, and if you don't, you better act like it. and it's easy to act like it. We can train your team, even if they're the first day on the job, valuable things and tips to say. So if they don't know anything at all, they will by the time we're done with them. So all the empathy, enthusiasm, flexibility, all those things become baseline. So think about what I absolutely expect, what I expect as a customer. I expect you to be empathetic with me. I expect you to be enthusiastic. I expect you to be nice. I expect you to use my name. I expect you to greet me like I'm the only one in your life at that time. I expect you to be versatile. I expect you to be flexible with me. I don't expect you to tell me, no, 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 no. I expect you to find a way to say yes. That's what I expect. And the other thing I expect is that you have balance. You know where I'm going, or you lead me in a direction that I would like to go. I expect that. I expect that when you sharpen your focus and you change your perception, I expect that you will deliver what I want. And you will deliver service that's not only exceptional, but it's going to make me a raving fan and tell all my friends and social media about, you know, how great you are. Okay? So that is the first point. There's so many points that I can talk about under this topic about sharpening your focus. Let me just see. Let's see how much time I'm running out. So yeah, sharpening your focus and your perspective. Now, the second bullet under this, and this is all stuff that I've used, I've trained, and it works. It absolutely works. So we talked about what I expect and how my perspective as a customer is all that matters. So when you focus and sharpen your perspective to focus on me, and many people don't think about it this way, these are things that when you are establishing a service culture, these things just don't, they have to be in there. There's absolutely no way that you can leave them out. I expect confidentiality. I expect any information that I give you is held in the strictest confidentiality. No one knows my information. No one's talking about my information. No one's leaving my information out on the desk so that everybody can see it, or that the next customer that comes up to the window can look over and see all my information. I expect confidentiality from you, business owner, period. I expect personal service. I expect that you're always going to be up when you are addressing me. I expect that I'm going to find some value in what you're offering me, because if I don't, I'm gone. Because all I want from you is a resolution to my problem. I don't want to know what your business does. I don't want to know the benefits of that product. I don't care. What I care about as a customer is, does it solve my problem? And will it solve my problem as we continue to go along? I expect you to be knowledgeable, okay? This is the experience attribute. This is the customer experience attribute, the perspective that you have to sharpen. The attribute of you being knowledgeable goes also with the service drivers. The first service drivers that I talked about were how well you know your job. That drives the service. You have to know your job. I talked about all of that as the first bullet for sharpening your perspective. Now, this attribute is the experience attribute. The customer experience attribute is when I said I want to be personal. I want you to give me personal service. I want confidentiality. Above all, you get my information, you keep it, and you keep it safely. I want you to be knowledgeable about me and what I need and how what you do can help me. And I want you to explain your course of action. This is an attribute that a lot of business owners and a lot of people don't get. I don't care if you're an entrepreneur. I don't care what your business is. I want you to explain to me your course of action. What are you going to do for me, and how are you going to do it? You're trying to sell me a product, a service. I want to know what it's going to do for me, and I want to know how you're going to do it for me. Simple as that. That's a very important attribute. And then I want to hear your recommendations. I expect that. How is this product going to help me solve my problem? So I want to hear those recommendations. I want you to explain that to me. And I don't mean I want you to say, no, this has this ingredient and that and the other. I want to know specifically, you know, your recommendations and how it's going to help me. This is fun. I want you to have a human touch. I mean, as a customer, I want you to be very, very human. I want you to understand me in every way that you possibly can. I want you to be courteous to me. I want you to be compassionate and empathetic and energetic and enthusiastic. I want all of that as a baseline. I don't want anything else. If you don't have this, now, everything that I'm describing, the service drivers, the experience that I have with you, this is baseline. This is what I call good. And remember, in the beginning of the program, I said good is not good enough. So if you have these things that I'm talking about, it's just good. I want to be clear that we're talking only good. We're not talking about exceptional customer experiences yet. We're just talking about good. All right, let me continue. So when you're courteous, when you're giving me all these great things that I'm talking about, you also have to be prompt and you have to be efficient with me. I don't expect a call back in 4 or 5 days when I've called you today. Okay? So be prompt and efficient, and please don't make me wait. I don't like to wait. But if I have to wait, I want you to tell me about how long it's going to be and why I have to wait. Okay? Don't make me wait without telling me. And I want, as a customer, I want it to be easy to do business with you. Whether it's by phone, whether it's via internet, whether it's on social media, whatever it is, if you're mobile phoning, if you're, you know, texting me, I want it to be easy to do business with you. Very easy. Now, when I say easy, if I can't contact you, if you're selling me a product that, okay, I think this is gonna really, really help be a good resolution to my problems. But then if I have a concern or a technical problem and I can't reach you, I have to search through the internet for a customer service phone number or how do I reach these guys? Or sometimes you see phone numbers only for current customers. Well, how am I gonna be a current customer If I can't ask questions? I have to first, you know, be able to understand. So make it easy to connect with you as a business owner. So now, this is only two of the attributes I'm talking about sharpening your perspective. Again, the first attribute under sharpening your perspective is all the service drivers. What I expect. Okay, I expect as a customer, you know your job, blah, blah, blah. I'm not going to go over that. The second attribute is the customer experience, the confidentiality. All the stuff that I've given you, you darn well, you darn better take good care of it. Blah, I got tongue-tied. Take good care of it. Be courteous to me. Understand. Give me the ability to contact you. That's the customer experience attribute. Now, the last attribute is an opportunity. I call it a behaviors opportunity. It's the opportunity for you to really focus on the perspective of your customer and make things happen, which will really convert to the profit strategy. This is where the money comes in. This is where the money, honey. So this last perspective for your perspective is the opportunity. Number one, your body language. You take a look at your body language and at your team's body language. What does it look like? Would you like to be helped by that person? You know, just take a look at the body language. What is the voice tone? Is the tone of voice, do you have a smile in your voice when you help me as your customer? Or do you have one of those, how can I help you, really robotic tones of voices? Okay, so do you proactively listen to me, or do you interrupt me every chance you get to say, we don't do that, we can't do that? Or are you thinking in advance about what your response is going to be instead of listening to me? Okay, these are behavior opportunities. These are opportunities for you to really focus on profits. When you listen to what your customer says, you repeat that back after they're done, you don't interrupt, you use that to sell and convert the customer to your product. Now, then you build rapport with me. Then you can sell me. You can upsell me, you can upgrade me, then I will listen to everything you have to say because you have satisfied the service drivers. You know your business. You know everything about me. You've been enthusiastic. You have gone down that list. You are now delivering. So when it comes to the opportunities, your body language is all about me. Your tone of voice is so smooth. You are smiling in your voice. Every time you say something to me, I get it. I'm like, I can't get my eyes off of you, or I have to keep listening to you if you're on the phone. You are building rapport with me. I get it. I like it. You could tell me now why you think that your product is going to solve my problem, and I'm going to go, yeah, it sure will. And then the other thing you can do now is you can say, not only will that product solve your problem, but I think this would help you along the way too, so you can upsell me, because you can go back and use everything that I said to you to upsell me. And I'm all ready, because I'm all focused, I'm ready, and I am just, I can't say no. So we'll be back with just a quick wrap up of this whole concept of the three secrets. Now we're kind of just going to review the three secrets of keeping your service spiced up. You're listening to Diana Price, and you're listening to Diana Price and Associates, Spicy Business Talk. We'll be right back.
Are you a diabetic? Need some energy? Need to quench your thirst? Try Pitbull Sugar-Free Energy Drink, the only energy drink named suitable for diabetics by the American Diabetic Association. And it's now available with no calories, no carbs, no sugar, and no fat, and a smooth, natural blend of energy, vitamins, and minerals. Need to quench your thirst? Try Pitbull Sugar-Free Energy Drink, the only energy drink named suitable for diabetics by the American Diabetic Association. And it's now available with no calories, no carbs, no sugar, and no fat, and a smooth, natural blend of energy, vitamins, and minerals. Pitbull Sugar-Free Energy Drink is the healthiest, best-tasting energy drink around. For more information and online ordering with free shipping, please visit hiphopbev.com. Remember, Pitbull Sugar-Free Energy Drink, suitable for diabetics, great for everyone.
Hi, welcome back. This is Diana Price. And you're listening to Diana Price and Associates and Spicy Business Talk. Oh, I have so much fun with what I do. My consulting firm is where we create the exceptional customer experiences, and it's just a blessing to be able to share these kind of things with you, particularly about the impact we all have on each other, which is phenomenal, and people just don't get that. But I sometimes confuse Diana Price and Associates, which is my consulting firm, with my show, which is Spicy Business Talk. So when you hear me doing these crazy interactions, you know that it's okay. It's all my company. It's all my team. So I want to just kind of go through why, you know, I wanted to talk about this subject today. It's just because sometimes we don't have the confidence that we need. We know our product, and we're just so charged up to sell, and we don't understand that you get paid for bringing value to your customers. You get paid for bringing value in a way that's different. And what I help you do is put some flavor in that value. And when I say put flavor in the value, you know, think about, get out of here, whatever you are, gnat flying around. Think about how you seed, how you make things happen. Think about what your core, your culture is, how and what flavor means. What does spicy mean to you? What does mild mean to you? What does boring mean to you? When you can get your hands gripped around what all that means, you understand that the confidence that you need to create a service culture, the perspective, the open mind, the focus, the attributes, the drivers, all the things we've talked about today, the opportunities, the confidentiality, all of that thing has to be wrapped up into your service culture so your customers pay for value. So if you don't have that foundation that we created today, if you don't have the value in spicing up your customer-centric culture, you're going to be lost along the way. Your GPS is going to veer off to a Y, and you just may take the wrong road. So again, I encourage you to have your culture in writing. If it's not in writing, it just does not exist. It doesn't exist at all. So think about what it is and what it is not. Just think about that. Think about what it is and what your culture is not. I want to just go ahead and just summarize what the three secrets. What are you missing? What do you think you're missing? How much of the little things are you missing in your business? We talked about, you know, how the teeny tiny little things, the gestures, the things that you kind of just overlook, and so your team overlooks. When I leave a message for you and you call me back 4 days later, you know, when your body language is such that I am not really important to you, those teeny little things are really important when it comes to your service culture. That's secret number one. And we spent a whole 15 minutes and didn't finish that part of it. So secret number one, how much of the little things are you missing? Secret number two, how do you set your tone and craft a culture that you really want? What is going to really be good for you? And whatever you have now, like I said, if it's good, it might not be good enough. How do you set that tone? Think about all the things that we talked about in the beginning of the show. Go back and re-listen to those little things and how to set the tone. Re-listen to each and every one of those things so you have a better grasp on how you can set the tone. Now, setting the tone is the very first S in my seven-step process. The seven-step process that I teach spells service, S-E-R-V-E-C-E. Today, we only have the chance to talk about setting the tone. That is the huge, that is the biggest, that's the most important one in the flavor and the spice in a customer-centric culture. And then we ended up with sharpening your perspective. So when you sharpen your perspective, you know, I'm not going to go through all that, but that's the third secret. That's the third secret to you getting exactly what you need in a service culture. Now, I want to just share a couple things about how you can fix the little things before you establish the culture that you need. I want you to figure out how to make those little improvements so you can make a big difference in winning customers or losing customers. So tell me, I hope you, did I give my Facebook page? Mm-hmm. Okay, facebook.com/spicybusinesstalk. I want you to tell me some of the little things that you're missing on Facebook, facebook.com/spicybusinesstalk. Just send me a post. Just say, I was listening to your show, you know, how to spice up your customer-centric culture. And I want you to tell me, what are some of the little improvements that you can make to make a big difference based on what you heard today? What are some of the little things you can make, some of the little improvements you can make to make a big difference in your customer-centric culture? And believe me, I rattle off so many of these today that I know you can come up with one or two. And I want to also share with you my thought of the day. I'm gonna start sharing some thoughts of the day on the show only because people have said, you know what? You have so many good details. You have so many good things that you're sharing with us. Why don't you do a thought of the day? So I decided I'm gonna give a thought of the day so you can use this. So it's gonna be called Spicy Thought of the Day. Did you get that? Spicy Thought of the Day. Now, we're going to put the spicy thought of the day on Facebook today. So go over later and check facebook.com Spicy Business Talk, because our thought of the day is the energy that you emit will attract a similar energy. If you wear a happy, spicy face, I didn't say smiling, if you wear a happy, spicy face, you will attract the same. If you wear a victim's face, you will be surrounded by victimization. Now, that is coming from a 20-year leadership strategist, business culture, so all kinds of awesome customer service sales that I have just not only experienced but led and internalized for in not only corporate America but also as an entrepreneur. So I want to encourage you to go back and really listen to this post, because the service interactions have to be spicy. They can't be bland. They can't be boring. And I only shared three little secrets with you today. Three secrets. And the secrets that I shared with you are so valuable, and there's nothing, absolutely nothing new. Because when customers interact with you, the things that they're going to look at, and I've mentioned this before, the things that they're going to look at, out of all of those three secrets I told you, are how do they relate to my five senses. Do you remember this five senses test? I think I told you the five senses test. Did I tell you guys that test here? The five senses test is, what does your business look like? In other words, what is your vision for service? Do I like your vision? What do you stand for? What do I see? What do I see when I'm around you, your team, when I'm in your space? What do I see? What's the look? That's the sense number one, the look. And then, what does it smell like? What does it smell like around here? So should I risk it? Does it smell fishy? Do I smell a problem coming on? What does it smell like? What does your business smell like? Ooh. That's huge. And then taste, that's the third sense, taste. Is it boring? I talk about this all the time. Is it boring? Is it bland? Is it spicy? Well, I like the flavor. Is it gonna be too peppery, too hot? We don't need too much spice now. Spice is not all about hot, it's about flavor. So, will I like the taste? Is it gonna be just enough for me? Is it gonna be too boring? Are you going to not be able to interact with me the way you're supposed to? What's the taste? What's the taste? Now, the fourth sense is hearing. Are you listening to me as a customer? Will I want more from you? What are you saying to me? Or are you just waiting for me to finish talking so you can say whatever you want to say? Are you listening? Am I going to want more from you? That's sense number four. And then the fifth sense is touch. Remember I told you, if you interact with me, if you don't transactionalize me, if you are compassionate, energetic, all those wonderful things in your own way, because you can't make them fake. If you fake them out, it's really going to break you. So if we feel the right way, then the touch of your business, if I can really internalize that touch, then I'm in. Then you can sell me. You have that opportunity now to not only sell me, to upsell me, but to keep me flowing through your pipeline as a business, as a repeat customer. So you get my business, so you keep my business. But I want you to listen to what I say. And I want you to be able to sensationalize a little bit and only spice it up to the point where it makes good sense and there's a good balance. You're listening to Diana Price, and this is Spicy Business Talk. And we hope you have enjoyed today the three secrets for customer-centric culture. And we'll see you next week.